Hey, my name is Shanshan. I sell art on shanshan.co and special on eBay. Today we're going to review The Invisible Man. So this is a film by Leah Whannell. The time is 2 hours, 4 minutes, so a little bit long, but you know, about that sweet spot of hour and a half. You get a little bit more story development here, so you get more character development. You have Elizabeth Moss play Cecily Cass, the wife, girlfriend of Adrian. Oliver Jackson Cohen plays Adrian Griffin, who's this optical scientist who becomes the Invisible Man. Harriet Dyer is Emily Cass, the sister of Cecilia. Adrius Hodge plays James Lerner Lanier, the cop friend of Cecilia. Storm Ride is Sydney Lanier, the daughter of the cop. So the story starts right when the young woman is escaping kind of this huge wealthy compound that her boyfriend husband has, Adrian has, and she runs, she has to set up all the cameras different, she has a stash bag, she runs out, scales the wall. Her sister meets her out on this desert path outside the house. She's like, go, go, go. And she's like, what? What's the hurry? And then all of a sudden her boyfriend shows up, breaks the window, and they're like, ah, they have to take off, right? So then she's hiding out at her friend's house, this cop, James Lanier. Everything seems fine. Then they get this, her sister shows up and she's like, why'd you show up? He knows where you live. He's going to stalk us. She's like, no, chill, man. It's like, here's his death warrant. And they're like, oh, that's weird. Why would he kill himself? So they go, the brother says, hey, you have this inheritance, but it's contingent on you not being crazy, right? So it's like, all right, whatever. And she's like, that's really weird. Why would he give me all this money? He didn't seem like that type of guy. So, you know, as the movie progresses, Invisible Man, you know, he's independently wealthy. So he's stalking her and making her look crazy. Like he slaps the cop's daughter. So then he's kind of like, you got to leave. You guys are crazy. Then he sets it up so it looks like she kills her own sister. And then she's sent into mental hospital. And then she finally figured out a way to catch him in the act of being invisible so she can make him visible again. And so it goes on from there and then end that you would expect as far as the Invisible Man finally kind of getting caught in a way. So this is kind of based on the original novel, 95, I think, by H.G. Wells. He wrote The Invisible Man. And in this one, it's more, I think, kind of a chemical solution. And he drinks the drink and it's kind of Jekyll and Hyde, but instead of turning into Mr. Hyde, he comes the Visible Man. But in this case, the scientist doesn't really have a lot of money and he stays in an inn, and so he has to rob banks, and then he followed around and finally is caught, right, by the townspeople beaten to death. So this one's different since he's independently wealthy. It's a little bit creepier because he's a sociopath right out of the bat, so he doesn't really need to rob people. He just kind of follows and stalks her around, which is even creepier. I mean, would he focus all his efforts on it? Maybe, because he's wealthy, right? So hard to say there, but that is kind of an interesting concept in that you'd have this creepy stalker ex-husband or whatever, and or boyfriend. I can't remember if it was a boyfriend or the husband. So that's kind of interesting how they're trying to make her crazy. Since he doesn't attack anyone else for a long time, it really does look like she's going crazy. So I think that's a pretty interesting twist on the story. There's also, it's a little bit based off The Invisible Woman, which was one of the sequels out of the original The Invisible Man movies that came out after the book, obviously. And in that one, it was like she got pregnant or something, and then the baby born is actually invisible as well. And so this one, you know, she's pregnant as well, so you're like, oh, you know. So they have a little bit of that twist, but obviously, since this is a suit versus a chemical, there's no way she's gonna have an invisible boy, right? So they shoot it kind of straight. It's not a comedy like The Invisible Woman, the original movie. So I like this concept. It has a really nice meat to it. Another thing you gotta think of is, in the original book, he starts deciding he's gonna torment society as the Visible Man, right? Because he can't become visible again. And so, and this chemical is kind of driving me more and more insane. He just gets more enlarged ego because he's invisible, so he can just attack people at large. But in the book and in the earlier movie, when he wears clothes, he's visible. So it's only really the chemical affects his skin. In this case, there's this optical suit with tiny cameras everywhere, which is more realistic probably than a chemical process, but still probably wouldn't be totally effectively invisible. It'd probably help you and keep you hidden, but not necessarily invisible in the real world. But it's an interesting concept. But yeah, I think you'd probably have more grandiose ideas than just stalking one particular idea. Why would this guy be obsessed with her? It's kind of, you know, that's kind of, I think, a little bit lacking in the film. They don't show why Adrian is attached to this girl so much. What I think I would have shot is I would have shot maybe one or two more minutes, a little small section in the beginning of the film, make that more act one a little bit longer. And instead of, like in the movie, the way they do it is she tells how she's a psychopath. The only thing you know is he comes and chases her from his mansion, and you're like, okay, so he's crazy, but you don't know how crazy, right? So it kind of, you go like, oh, he might be that crazy, and then you see he's really crazy, right? I think if you had shown like them eating, and then she's like, eat the steak, don't eat that, eat this, you're eating too much, you're gonna get fat, da da da, like a really controlling aspect. And then like they go out to dinner or something or some event, and she's like, no, you can't wear that, that's too flashy, da 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 da. And just a little bit of those effects would show how controlled she is versus she tells it and you're like, all right. But if you show it visually, it's a visual medium, show that he's a psychopath, I think that would have been more effective in my mind. There's another interesting idea is, in this movie, the actual brother of the sociopath boyfriend, Adrian, he turns out to be one of the guys wearing an invisible suit as well. And so at that point, it's kind of turned up, well, was it the brother? Was it the husband? And the way they shot the film, it's basically, you know, it's the husband. It makes more sense that it's a husband. But I think there could have been a little bit more leeway to show maybe the brother had some kind of romantic notion about the girl as well, or some craziness, so you really didn't know the husband and the boyfriend. That would have been a really cool impact to kind of give it a little bit more who did it kind of thing in the film. And this way you kind of know it's him, and then it's just the other characters in the film are just kind of idiots, so they're thinking, no, it's the brother, he's locked up in the house, and you're like, okay. But they could have shot a little bit different there to make it more of a mystery. I think that would have been more of a cooler idea, because it had a good premise to have in there, but then it doesn't feel like it's the brother at all. It just feels like he happened to be helping his brother Adrian, but you don't know why he's helping his brother Adrian. Is the guy threatening him? There's no mention of that. There could have been like a little bit of a plot giveaway as far as maybe, you know, somehow, why is the brother able to hold his other brother? Why is Invisible Man able to hold his brother in such a hold grasp? You know, is he getting benefits? You know, what is it? You don't really know. They touch on that a little bit, like he say he's controlling or whatever, but again, there's no backstory. I don't know if you need to shoot it, but you definitely need to have some explanation there, or just a little bit. That way they give a little more sauce to it. The other weird thing is they have this weird letter that she sends out. He hacks her computer and sends an email off to her sister and says, I never want to see you again. And then her system's immediately like, yeah, I believe it. Like, really? I don't know if that one, you just said one letter and then the person's like, fuck you. That kind of doesn't make any sense. Like if someone called you up and said, I didn't write that email, someone hacked my email. Like, why wouldn't you believe your own sister versus like you get this one email and say, you know, it's like, who hasn't been hacked before? Everyone's heard about people getting hacked for the social security numbers, telephones. So it's like, you know, would you believe your sister in person versus some stupid email? That's, you know, a little bit of a hole in the plot. I mean, it is what it is. I think it kind of makes sense, but in a way it doesn't make sense. Like, one email, would it trigger someone to break a relationship lifelong? Unless that relationship had already been a little bit on edge. So there might have been a little bit of backstory to kind of show that the sisters were close, but then something happened, and then it would encourage the break later with email. They're just really like, she helps her rescuer, they set up her friend's house, and then the email, she's like, poof, you know. So they need a little bit more foreshadowing there, I think, to kind of show that the relationship's going south. Like, somehow the Invisible Man's tormenting the sister somehow, and that would have made much more sense. So they probably should have shot a few scenes with the sister being tormented maybe by the Invisible Man somehow, besides just one email. Of course, in the film, you have limited footage, so you really need to reduce it to maybe one email kind of thing. So how you would shoot that, I'm not sure. But I think there's a little bit more story to add there. Yeah, so obviously, it being invisible, you have to use camera tricks. And they do that to an extent, like the person will be here, and then they move the camera over here, and you're like, why is the camera here? So obviously they're suggesting the Invisible Man's over here. But I didn't feel like when he was completely invisible, they didn't have a lot of camera tricks that really suggested he was there, which would have been a much cooler kind of thing. Like maybe a curtain moves a little bit, or you see a little bit of a shadow, weird shadow on the floor. They just didn't have those elements, so it just felt like, is he there? Is she crazy? You don't know. So that would have been kind of interesting if they had played more with a little bit with the shadows. She sees the shadows, but then other people don't see the shadow because he's able to kind of cover his tracks right away. That would have been more, you know, a little bit more creepier, I think. And so when they wrestle around, those are really good special effects. Obviously, with the CGI now, it's much better. I think in the 33 films, the way they shot it is the person would have to wear all black velvet with the bandages on top. And they would have to shoot it scene by scene and then cut it between the same scene plus the Invisible Man and then stitch those films over top of each other. So it's a very difficult film editing process in the 1933s to make this, you know, look like a really creepy film. Now you have CGI, and then you just, you know, kind of pull the person around on ropes and strings and then edit the strings and ropes out, obviously. So I think they did a pretty good job there. They didn't have much CGI as far as pulling the hair. I think one time it looks like she's getting her hair pulled, but then it doesn't. You don't see her hair hanging out like this. It just seems like she's somehow getting pulled from the back, which, you know, I guess he could have grabbed her by the roots and then it wouldn't show as much, but they probably should have done something with her hair, maybe with some spongies or whatever, to hold her hair back and then edit those out. So a little bit more tighter editing. I think they could have done a little better job on the CGI. I mean, it's way better, obviously, than the originals in the 30s. But yeah, I thought it was pretty good, but there could have been a little bit more, yeah, just kind of evidence that the Invisible Man's there somehow or he's not there. They do have to show, like, you don't know if she's crazy or not. So that's kind of a fun element that, you know, is she imagining it? Is she not imagining it? So I think that's kind of what the director's after here. So that's kind of an interesting aspect as far as, you know, is she crazy? Is she becoming crazy? Is he there? Is he not there? So they play with that and the element, which is a kind of a fun way to shoot the film. I think I would have shot some of the shadows. They don't show the shadows at all. There are houses where you have the ambient light from all directions, so then you might not have a shadow. But, you know, I kind of find it hard to believe. I mean, right now I have a slight shadow, so why wouldn't you have a shadow? It is possible to kind of create the lighting so it doesn't look like shadow. So that's kind of a camera effect, which isn't obvious. It's only obvious because I shoot film a little bit, you know, for these or my painting videos. So I kind of know, like, you would have a shadow, right? So, you know, I think there's kind of a little bit of a letdown there. Yeah, I mean, I think overall it's a pretty good film. I would recommend it. It's a really fun, I don't think you'd be collecting it per se, but it's definitely a one watch good film, maybe a good date night out. So I recommend it. And if you want to subscribe, you can subscribe below. And I'll see you in the next movie review. Thanks for watching, guys.